respect to all the devotees, I want to recite a hymn written by Dr. Karan Singh ji in English and in Hindi. To Lord Shiva, I am your plaything. You can breathe into me the fire of eternal life, or you can scatter my atoms to the far corners of the universe so that I disappear forever. You can fill me with the light and power so that I can shine like a star, or you can extinguish my spirit so that I sink forever into the fathomless ocean of time. You can set me among the eternal stars, resplendent with your divine fire, or you can hurl me into the abyss of darkness so that I can never again be visible to mortal eyes. You can come to me with the glory of 1,000 cubits, or you can turn from me and leave me stranded in the gray and ghastly desert of the sky. You can smile at me with the radiance that kindles the universe, or you can open your eye of fury and reduce me to a heap of ashes. I am your plaything. The choice is yours. Jai Nataraj, Shiva Shankar, Markande ke Rakshak, Tripura ke Bhakshak, Tripura Asur ke Bhakshak, मेरे साथ क्या व्यवहार करोगे? तुम मुझे शक्ति और प्रकाश से भर सकते हो ताकि मैं चमकूं, उनका पिंड गवादी आकाश में, मध्यरात्रि की अंधकार में, या तुम मेरे प्राण दे सकते हो? तुम मुझे दैव अग्नि से दीप्तमान तारों के बीच जोड़ सकते हो। मैं तुम्हारा खिलौना हूं, निर्णय तुम्हारा है। यदि भस्म करने का ही निर्णय हो वो भी कोई आपत्ति नहीं। हाँ, एक अनुरोध अवश्य, उसके बाद मेरे भस्म को अपना शरीर पर लगा लेना। थैंक यू।
गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, गुड इवनिंग ऑल ब्रदर्स, अ ग्रेट वेलकम टू डॉक्टर करण सिंह, डॉक्टर किरण बेदी एंड डॉक्टर मनोज दास एंड मिस्टर संजय आर्य। Today's evening is going to be presided by Dr. Kiran Bedi. But before that, I wanted to share my association with Dr. Karan Singh. This evening belongs to him. It is for his book launch. Dr. Karan Singh has done a lot for this country. In fact, when he got the Padmashree, the then president said that this prize gets honored, the whole country gets honored, because you are getting this prize. He comes from Jammu and Kashmir. He is the son of the Maharaja. He comes and meets with us as if with everybody equally, with total humility and friendship and love. I have had the opportunity of working with him and making several statues which have been installed as a symbolic spiritual power of India, not only in the Indian Parliament House several years ago, but also at the UNESCO in Paris. There is no other personality except right now Shri Aurobindo, representing the need of a spiritual heritage protection in the world. And that goes thanks again to Dr. Karan Singh. I would like to say that Dr. Kiran Bedi doesn't need introduction in Padmashree.
Don't do it then.
That's why I'm not going to do it. Manojda is...
Neither do I.
Neither do Manojda. But I just want to tell you that he has been my professor, the beloved bilingual, literary great figure of our country. And so it's a great experience for us that you have all humbly agreed to come and share this evening in Vaitikuppam in Pondicherry, sharing two events. Before we start the book section of Dr. Karan Singh, I would request him to launch the Aurodhan catalogue, which actually encompasses and archives, which we have also learned from Dr. Kiran Bedi to archive things, all the 190 events that have been done in this year. And I want to just tell you two incidents, what it has done. The emphasis has been on oneness. I remember few years ago, I was invited by then Governor Dr. Surjit Singh Barnala, and he said, I have a Christmas party, can you do an event? So when I went there and did an event, I announced exactly what has happened through oneness through art. I said, today I'm going to present to you Ramli Ibrahim, an artist of Muslim origin, who is going to perform for you a dance of Hindu origin, the Odissi, and for a Christmas party and a Sikh governor. This is what oneness can do. And more recently, we had an exhibition of one of the Pondicherry artists, and this gentleman practices a religion, the Muslim religion. And he came with those beautiful family, with those beautiful dress, and they were all there. And I went and told him, listen, I'm going to start my news program with the shloka. He said, don't worry, there is a gentleman who's a Christian who's going to inaugurate my show. So this is what oneness does. We in Aurodhan have tried to identify the human thirst of oneness. Thanks to all of you that we have been able to do this. I would request Dr. Karan Singh to just launch the Aurodhan catalogue, and then we can start the evening for launching his book.
Madam President, Dr. Kiran Bedi, the most significant head of the Union Territory ever, of the significant Union Territory. Dr. Karan Singh Ji, Revered Dr. Karan Singh Ji, Sanjay Ji, Sriman Lalit, and dear friends, ladies and gentlemen. I have been asked to speak a few words about the book which is going to be launched. As I went through the book, a very irresistible legend came to my mind. I will present it, slightly editing it. The legend is like this. It was a moonlit night, a long, long road. Three horsemen were galloping forward. At one point of their march, there's a huge tree, and suddenly they hear a voice, stop and dismount. Almost hypnotized, they get down from the horses and wait for the message. And the tremendous voice says, pick up these pebbles as much as you want.
Well,
nervous they do it. And the voice quietly says, go forward. Once you have reached your destination, you will be both sad and happy. Very intriguing, prophecy. You will be both sad and happy. So the horsemen went, and when they reached their destination, they took out the pebbles. All the pebbles had been turned into diamond pieces. They were happy, but they were sad because they did not take more. They did not pick up more. That is the legend. I will edit it. I will say, there was a fourth horseman behind them. And he had picked up all the pebbles, his pockets all full. And all of them had turned into diamond. The pebbles, the path represented the path of life. The pebbles represented the experiences one could derive out of life. And so, the fourth horseman was Dr. Karan Singh. Many lives in one life. And the diamonds he has collected, you can find them in this anthology. I am surprised because I know both the depth and height of his scholarship. All Indian mythology, history, philosophy, political philosophy. But I am surprised how he avoids pedantry in writing. He could quote many, many difficult passages for us to be impressed. He could make the presentation very complex. But what he writes is simple, non-pedantic truth from his heart, but at once convincing and highly readable. Needless to say, as I say, many lives in one life. Dr. Karan Singh, the Prince, His Highness, Maharaja Hari Singh's resident, Sadai Riyasat, the youngest cabinet minister ever, diplomat, author, poet, and last but not the least, unannounced ambassador of Indian culture, Indian spirit to all the countries of the world. And his experiences under different sections have beautifully come together and be presented in this book. This is all I can say in the way of introducing the book, because you have to read it. It is a highly readable book, but at the same time, at no point of your reading, you will ever falter or stop or question the ideas. They are so transparent, so honest, and so beautifully put. Dear friends, one thing that has always amazed me, and it will never cease amazing me, however many times I can tell it. Only people of my generation, I am in second part of 80s now, can appreciate what I am going to tell you. Dr. Karan Singh, the prince and heir to the throne of the most lovable kingdom, state of India, Jammu and Kashmir. Should I say born with a silver spoon? No, silver, diamond is poisonous, no, platinum spoon, let it be. But what is surprising, in his teens, he chooses a subject for his thesis. You see, he belongs to a dynasty which, by natural law of things, is an ally of the British rulers. And the sole heir to the throne of that dynasty chooses a subject for his PhD thesis, Shri Aurobindo. Here it will be just a matter of coincidence. I think this is something providential, ordained. It speaks of the evolution, the evolved status of a soul. It is not immediately possible to comprehend the significance, the big gap between the royalty and what Sri Aurobindo means in those days. But that is what makes the difference between everybody else and Dr. Karan Singh. I commend you to read the book. That's a wonderful thing you have done in Aurodhan. What an atmosphere, what a peace, and at the same time what a cultural milieu you have created. And naturally you deserve the recognition from our very dear Lieutenant Governor and people like Dr. Karan Singh. Karan Singh, of course, always have been a patron to you. So thank you very much for coming and giving me a year.
I will request Dr. Kiran Bedi, Lieutenant Governor of Padmashree, to release Dr. Karan Singh's book. I would request Dr. Karan Singh to enlighten us.
Sir, tell us about your, when you were growing up with your father. No, sir, don't tell us this. Tell us about your personal story, which is not here. Tell us about your father, your kingdom, about Jammu and Kashmir. Tell us about that, sir.
If you want to learn about my childhood and my growing up, you will have to read my autobiography. It's all laid out in that very clearly. But I never look back. One of the secrets of my life has been, Kiranji, that I have never looked back, either in anger or in regret. Wo ek gana hai na, Devanand ne gaya hai, jo mil gaya usi ko muqaddar samajh liya, jo kho diya usse hum bhulate chale gaye. If I look back upon the kingdom and the ghodas and the hathis and the processions and all, it is no use, because that is an age that has disappeared. That age is not going to come again. And there are no regrets, because...
Lisa, but tell us your story.
My story is something which, you know, I really can't tell you. But let me, first of all, before I say anything else, let me congratulate Lalit and Shanaz Verma for Aurodhan and for all that they have done in Pondicherry for the promotion of art. It is quite extraordinary that in 1 year, they have done all these over 100 functions. I don't think any other impresario in India would have this sort of a record. The catalogue of 1 year's activity itself is a collector's item. So I'd like to congratulate Lalit and Shanaz. We've had so many beautiful evenings here that this place is redolent with art and with music and all. And that is something really I'd like to touch upon. The point that he made, I'll come back to my childhood if you like, but the point that he made, that art and culture is one thing which cuts across all barriers. Barriers of caste, barriers of creed, barriers of religion. It is a unifying factor. It is a factor that is universal. A piece of art can be appreciated by anybody regardless of what religion they come from. Music is something, Shri Aurobindo in one of his poems says, all music is only the sound of his laughter. What a beautiful line. All music is only the sound of his laughter. Because music is something that really touches our innermost heart. And without music, I don't think really life would be worth living, frankly. Because music is there everywhere. And going back to my childhood, my mother was from a small village in Kangra. And growing up, I learned from her these folk songs of Kangra, and which I have now sung. I've recorded them in various cassettes. That is where I learned folk music. Then my father was a very great connoisseur of classical music. So from the age of 12, I had to sit and practice my music every day. And very often he used to seat me in front of him and say, he's doing his work, you do your riyaz. So I learned classical music for 15 or 20 years from teachers, including Pandit Umagat Sharma, who is the father of Shiv Kumar Sharma, the great santur player. His father was my guru, and I learned music. So I love classical music. I still have practiced ayriyas once a week for 1 hour. And the third stream of my music is rock music. I'm a rock addict. You'll be surprised to know. I've been a rock addict from the time of Bill Haley and the Comets, long before Elvis Presley came on the scene. And all the way down from there, down through the 80s, down to Whitney Houston and Madonna and Dire Straits and Billy Joel and Pet Shop Boys and all. I love rock music. So I mean, this is a divine gift, a Triveni, the folk music of the Dogra folk music, the classical music of our Sanskriti, of our culture, and the music of the West. So all of these three, to my mind, are sound of his laughter, are beautiful. And therefore I think that in a world today, Kiranji particularly, when the forces of disintegration and hatred and social unrest are there, art and music is something that has to be developed and has to be. And as I grew up in a very different atmosphere. Till the age of 11, I was living in our own place with two other companions. I didn't live with my parents. From the age of six, I was separately brought up with two other companions with a separate house. And I was allowed to meet my father only once a week.
Wow.
And my mother every three times a week.
Why?
Well, you'll have to ask my father, he's gone now. He can't tell you that. Because I'll tell you why. He was convinced that if I grew up in the court, I would be thoroughly spoiled. Ek hi ladka hai, sar chadha ke rakhenge sab, aur bigad jayega. Isliye unhone shuru se hi dev, he made me grow up separately. From the age of 11, plus I went to Doon School. Doon School also, that was at that time a very progressive measure. Now it is looked upon as an elitist school. But in those days, all the princes went to Mayo College or to Rajkumar College and so on. Going to a public school where you had to do all your own work and clean your shoes and make your bed, that is something which also was very valuable for me. But that gave me comparatively a deeper understanding of the realities of life. So I didn't grow up in an unreal atmosphere, as somebody might think, a royal ghar mein rahe ko kya pata. And my mother was a village girl. So from childhood she would tell me, hey, whatever you have to do, do for the poor. Garibon ke liye karo, ameer tumhara paisa bhi lenge, tumhare virudh bhi jayenge. The rich people will take your money and also oppose you. So all your life try and do something for the people. And that was one of the reasons that impelled me into political life. I got into political life at the age of 18. Because my father, under unfortunate circumstances, had to leave the state. And he appointed me regent in his place. So from the age of 18, I had the blessings of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and all these great leaders. So I grew up learning from them. Dr. Radhakrishnan, I looked upon also as a guru. Then there was a change from region to Sadr-e Riyasat, elected head of state. Then I became elected head of state. Then I became governor. So by the time I had completed 18 years of my public life, I had already gone through these experiences. And at the age of 36, I joined Indira Gandhi's cabinet as a full cabinet minister, and was a cabinet minister for 10 years, from 67 to 77, during which I saw her in her finest hour, which was the Bangladesh war, and in perhaps the darkest hour, which was the emergency. I lived through that. I was in the cabinet for both those great occasions, and they are memorable events. And from then onwards, I've had a lot of experiences going from various country to country. Traveling was very important for me, because my wife, I must say, a lot of what I have achieved is due to her. My wife was from Nepal. Her name was Yasho Rajya Lakshmi. By marrying her, I got Yash also, which is fame, Raj also, which is political power, and Lakshmi also, which is wealth. So thanks to her, it is thanks to her that I was able to go through all these years, very difficult years, ups and downs politically, in and out. 40 years in Parliament, Kiranji, both in the Raj Sabha and the Lok Sabha, both on the treasury benches and in the opposition. So I've had a very wide experience of public life. Every single election from 1952 to 2019, I have either participated in or I have witnessed. And all the prime ministers, from Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who I looked upon as my mentor, all the way to Narendra Bhai Modi, I've known each one of them. And each one of them is a fascinating story. Ek-ek batata rahun, so it will take me years to describe each one of them. I've known all of them, all the presidents, from Babu Rajendra Prasad down to Shri Kovind now. So I've had these experiences. But I must say one thing. Politics is a very difficult game, and one tends to get stuck in it. What I was able to do by the divine grace is I went through all these experiences, but I never got stuck in any of them. I tried to have a sense of inner detachment. I am a Shiva Bhakta, yat yat karma karomi tat tat ahilam sambho tava aradhanam. Whatever experience I have, I try and dedicate it to the divine. And that leaves me free from the attachment and the craving. As you know, there are people who, once they get a job, they're obsessed with it. I want to become this, I want to become that. There were many people who wanted me to become President of India. And Veer Sanghvi wrote, Kiran, if you remember in an article, Karan Singh is the best president India never had. So, but I had no obsession with that. I'm quite happier living in my own house than in Rashtrapati Bhavan. There are too many steps, and anyhow, I couldn't have climbed all those steps in Rashtrapati Bhavan. So, the thing to do is to go through life with a certain sense of detachment, number one, and not only a negative detachment, but a positive dedication to the divine. So, if you can combine the two, an inner detachment and an inner dedication, I think that gives you the power and the capacity to deal with the problems of life boldly and face them. Manoj, he has been very kind. He's always been very close to me. As you know, he's a very famous Odia author, winner of so many Sahitya Academy and other awards, a great devotee of Sri Aurobindo. And people like him I've come in touch with. All the great literators, I was 12 years president of the selection committee of the Gyanpith Award. So in that capacity, I met all the great writers from across the country, Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, all of them. And I was able to interact with them. So I've been very fortunate. I've had such a lot of experiences, such a lot of inputs I've had, which very few people have had. But I'm very grateful to the Divine, to Lord Shiva, for giving me these experiences and for giving me the opportunity to mingle with people like you, to interact with people like you. Because every person, Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Hriddeshe Tishtati, the Lord resides in the heart of all beings. And therefore there is no person, howsoever humble he may be, who does not have a spark of the divine within him or her. And that is something we must cherish, we must honor. I must say that the recent situation, I don't want to go into the politics of it, but there's a turmoil everywhere. There's a Samudra Manthan. If you look at the whole structure of India today, from Kashmir right down to Kanyakumari, there's turmoil. Young people are in ferment. Young people are coming out. So there's this Samudra Manthan, the churning of consciousness is taking place. And remember what happened with the Samudra Manthana, the mythological Samudra Manthana, where both the Devas and the Asuras cooperated. First what happened was the Garala came out, the poison came out. It was only when Lord Shiva swallowed that poison and integrated it into his throat that then the other Ratnas came out. We are witnessing, I think, Kiranji, we are witnessing a Samudravan. What comes out of it, let us see. Now we cannot expect Lord Shiva to come, but each one of us, in the crucible of our individual consciousness, must take a part of that poison and through our sadhana convert it into amrita and give it back to society. That, I think, is the task before us today. And that is what I would like to leave you with. That is our task. It is a privilege to be alive at this time. It's a privilege to be able to participate in what is happening. Some people are negative, they're very depressed. They say, I'm not depressed. I've seen so many ups and downs in my life. I've seen my father's reign at its height and then the fall. I've seen Indira Gandhi's reign at its height and then the fall. Nobody ever goes up forever. You go up for a while and then you start coming down. There is a self-regulating mechanism in our body politic, in our psyche, collective psyche, that ensures that if we lean too much in one direction, the other forces come into action. So we're living at a very exciting time. I can only hope and pray that the Divine gives us the wisdom and the courage to confront the situation that is before us and to play a positive and active role in its successful outcome. Thank you very much.
I would request Dr. Kiran Bedi to enlighten us too. Thank you.
I have been a listener and an ardent student of whatever he used to say. Being a Delhiite, my friends, I've heard Dr. Karan Singh many times. I had an opportunity at the India International Center when he used to speak and many other lectures. We used to devour every word of his. So I've been literally a student of and with his kind of, the kind of investment of life he's invested into this country. We all have been his students in one form or the other. Like my colleagues, Mr. Sundaresan, said he heard Dr. Karan Singh over the radio so many years ago as a student. So we've all actually grown up listening to him, reading him, but more listening to him, because he was constantly reaching out and communicating with the city and around. But this essay, when I got this book, and thanks to Lalit, I got this book, and he said, you are coming in this book, though Saturday evening is a recovery time for the Lieutenant Governor's office. But this is absolute rejuvenation. When I got your book and I started to read, I felt you speaking to us again. Because this book is all what I used to hear. And this all for me, a change in the world. So when I read this, it recalled many times I heard him. And today I had his words in my hand. Thanks to this, whoever has done this, Jupiter, who's done it? You've done a great job. Thank you, you've done a good job. In fact, like we have essays of many other laureates, this is that book called Going to Literature, Indian Literature. It's an Indian literature book where honors, thoughts, etc. have to be read as essays. Each word, when I start to also read it, it was, but I'm more out of, I'm going to tell you what I've read and what helped me recall. I'll share with you some portion which I loved. And this is something to take along. I owe also personal gratitude to Dr. Karan Singh. He was one who ever went to him and deserved that help, got it. I was then IGP prison, and I felt that work which has happened in the prison by grace, it has to be documented. And it just happened, it happened, it happened out of nothing. So much happened. So I felt that it, otherwise this would go down and in memory. It will go down in the memory, means it will go away with me. So I heard of the Nehru Scholarship, and he was heading the Nehru Memorial Fund with Mr. Natwar Singh. They were very good team members. And I thought, how do I document this work? I heard that every time under Nehruji's birthday and his death anniversary, they announce Nehru Fellows. So I start to wonder that this work, if it's not written, it will go away. It has to be documented. How do I document it? And I read about the Nehru Fellowship, of which he was heading. And I thought, I will. And then Mr. Natra Singh was my tennis friend. I went to him, I said, I want to write this work. Huh? But I need resource right now, because I would need a genuine study leave. He said, apply. You apply. I'd already finished with the dates. They were expired. Can you believe it? Have you ever got a Nehru Fellowship with one page note? I just wrote one page note. And I gave it to Mr. Natra Singh. It reached him. I got the Nehru Fellowship because of their large-heartedness, their creativity, the vision. They felt, yes, genuinely needed to be written. And in the Nehru Fellowship, there's a condition that if you earn that fellowship for 2 years, the third year has to be in publication. Sir, I owe my book, It's Always Possible, to you. And I mentioned that in the book, that I owe it to them. Look, little things, how life, they made the difference in ordinary people's lives in ours. And how that little extraordinary cine got rubbed off on us with these kinds of books. And that book took me around the world, traveling, presenting it all over. So I have also come here to express my personal gratitude. I do not know when did I express it directly, but here I'm publicly expressing it because I owe this to him. So while I want to say that when I got this book, I couldn't put it down. So I looked for what attracts me more, but every chapter attracts. When you go through the index, you can't put it down. First of all, I think we need to resolve and appeal that time is good for a biopic on his life. It's a biopic the world must see of Dr. Karan Singh. How do we get this movement going? Lalit? Isn't it? Or sabke aa rahe ab inki aani chahiye, and while he's still around, then he can correct it also and give the final authenticity to it. Isn't it? So I think there has to be a new movement of a biopic on his life. We got living legend. Sir is the biggest living legend, and the cinema's living legend. We already got junior ones of MS Dhoni's, etc. We can have one of the cinema's living legend we have of the biopic on Dr. Karan Singh. We need to have a movement on this. I'm sure it will happen one day. It will happen. Nature will conspire. Lord Shiva will send it. I'll tell you what I loved reading. I love the subject of four pillars of learning. Four pillars of learning. And I start because I want to, we're all students, as I told you, I'm a student. First pillar of this chapter 37. The first chapter of his learning, first learning is, and I have my intern students here with Raj Nawaz, and they'll be keen to know. First pillar of learning. Should I ask him to tell you rather than I read it? Yes.
Learning to know.
Fourth. Learning to be is the fourth.
Learning to know is the first pillar.
That's right.
Learning to do is the second pillar. Learning to live together is the third pillar. And learning to be is the fourth pillar.
This is the chapter on food. See how he shrunk my 5 minutes into a few seconds. And this is explained in this book. How first pillar is where he said Gyan Yoga, which is first is learning to know the Gyan Yoga. The Gyan Yoga, he says, there's now a massive explosion with information. And from information, we have to construct knowledge. And from the knowledge, we have to distill wisdom. And there's so much material, but the capacity to know is very important. All the physics. So first of all is wanting to know, willingness to know, Gyan Yoga. Second pillar is learning to do. And that's where he talked about the skill development, which the government schemes are, but learning to do. And he talked about that there's so many IITs, where are the ITIs in between? The graduation and the IITs, where is the learning to do? In fact, ideally, if you want, this is what China does, this is what Korea is doing, and many other countries, Japanese do, from while in 10th standard Government of India has been doing, learning to do. That was how 10 plus 2 came. For a while, weren't you with education? You, culture and tourism, of course, for a while. Learning to do, if you ask me, what the Indian bureaucracy really needs at the moment, the IAS and the IPS, etc., we're coming into the service too late. In fact, we need to come at the stage of learning to do. 12th standard onwards, if there would be a national competition, like we have the for entering into MBAs, etc., or the IITs, etc., if we would have a national competition at the 12th standard on wanting to be civil servants, take the exam, and then get into these liberal arts, literature, history, geography, economics, psychology, commerce, IT, all this. At the moment, what's happening in our service is we're getting engineers and doctors and mathematicians. They're getting full marks. He's asked in this, he said, when he was doing his master's, he said, how are you getting 100% marks in English paper? 100%, he says, he and I got 70%, 73%. Because in liberal arts, how do you get 100 out of 100? So why is it 100 out of 100? I don't know for what reason. But today, I've noticed in our Indian administrative services, it's a matter of serious questioning. Engineers should have been in the factories. And doctors should have been in the hospitals. What are they doing in the Indian administrative service? Why? Because they score very high. They score very high, they get full marks. And passing in the interview is not compulsory. You fail in the interview, yet you can pass if you scored very high. So you get doctors, they don't necessarily, if you ask me, I'm not making a controversial statement. It's just a personal statement. Because administration of patient is brilliant with the doctor. Running of factory is brilliant with the engineer. But what about general administration? So what really I think indeed, it's coming out of this learning is, when it's a learning to know, learning to do, is that learning to do is not happening early in administration. It's all learning by trial and error. So by the time you make the error, a lot of damage has happened because people have lost out on policies and funds. Third pillar is learning to live together, as we said. And most of us have learned to live together with large joint families. And now you're not learning, now we're learning to live together with Facebook. We're learning to live together with our Twitter accounts. We're learning to live together with social media, but not with society as a whole. Actually, it's taken us away because there's so much happening here that you don't want to lose on that. So now it's no more living together. It's living together with technology, not with humankind. This is the third, and he fourth, of course, saying learning to be. This is a chapter you friends must read. It's learning to be what he talked about his philosophy when the poetry was read. And he also writes in this book that prose is for reading, poetry is for listening. That's what he said. So the moment when Lalit said, here is poetry being going to be read, I said, that's exactly what he loves to hear, his poetry to be read. This is all friends. This is one book which should and could and one day reach the honor schools and the masters in literature and essay reading, like we read others' essays of the greatest Greek thinkers and others. One day, hopefully, our youth could be reading these essays, and every essay is knowledge. It's energy. It's also wisdom. It's also experience. It's also spirituality. He loves the factor of spirituality. He says religion we can belong to, but he defines beautifully the distinction between religion and spirituality. So I'm very grateful that I got the gift of this book, but for me, it was reading when I was listening to him. I have not introduced him because I can't. None of us can. But what we would love to do is to see one day, while we are still around, is to see his biopic. He hasn't shared his experience as ambassador in the United States. I think that would be a whole experience by itself when he was India's ambassador in the United States. He must have been the richest cultural czar for us in the Western world. And whatever he... Look at the moment what he has of the Upanishads, the Rig Vedas, the Puranas. He's, He's a parrot of that. This book is full of that. What the West must have heard him is of the Yoginandas, or the Isha Foundations, or the Art of Livings which are going, or the Vivekanandas. And he's written a wonderful 1.5 page, and even Vivekananda, it's just brilliant. So I would say that this is a must read for youngsters, young and old, and pass it on if you are into a teaching academy or in administration, to say, here's a book to be read and digested. This is the maximum justice I could do to this release of this book. Words are short when you are up against a Padma Vibhushan. So friends, here we are. We are very fortunate that Lalit has given us this opportunity to be on the side, on the left of Dr. Karan Singh, but on the right of Manoj Das. Right? Both brilliant. I've written a few books. They've written literatures and scriptures, but I've learned to write a few, and I think you had a role in my first book.
Yeah,
one of them. Anyway, so friends, thank you so much, Lalit, for inviting me. And you know, every time he invites me for a Saturday, I tell him, no, I've got to do something else. But you see, this is one where Dr. Karan Singh, a living legend, gives us an opportunity to hear, to read, and hear him once again. That's why my curiosity as a student came back again. Tell us about your upbringing. Even though one has to go back, but hearing is better than reading, isn't it? So can we ask him more? Can I interview him? May I interview you on your behalf? Okay, go ahead and interview. Please shoot questions. You. This is a rare opportunity. Hey, you youngsters, what's your question? Come on, question. Ask.
Sir, what has been the happiest moment of your life, if there's one moment which you could tell us, and what ignited your vision for serving our country? And your stature is widely known, your talk across my university as well. Now we have debates upon what's happening in Jammu and Kashmir. So you're an icon for all of us, and what has been one happiest moment if you could tell us, and one challenging moment as well, and how you overcame that? And one of the past and one of the present.
Only one question.
Okay.
Only one question. Happiest moment. Now sit down, pass it on to the next. Okay.
Happiest moment. I would say watching Yamini Krishnamurti dancing the Natanamadhyaya.
Wow.
That is something that transports me to a different world. The Natana Madhira and Lord Shiva danced in the Swarana Mandapa in Chidambaram, and it describes the dance of Shiva. That is the most beautiful thing, and that gives me tremendous boost.
Thank you.
So one short question every time.
People like nowadays, especially young generation, for small things, they are dying for no reason. So for them, when they are in a low period, how they should overcome that situations, and when you are in your life, when you are in low situation, how you overcome from that?
You see, young people really are not governed by any rational calculations. They work from their hearts. And if they feel that they are wrong, if they feel that they have been unjustly treated, then they will react. That is what the young people do. It is, we can always tell them, don't react, but the fact of the matter is, it's only when young people start reacting that society begins to change. If you look at the freedom movement also, it was when young people came out on the streets, or the JP movement, when young people came out on the streets, then the whole situation, the whole structure changes. So I think on the one hand, it is very painful to see students being beaten. I mean, it's a horrible thing to see. And this is the future of India. But also, we must now understand what is it that is impelling them to move? What is it that is impelling them to leave their comfortable lives and come out onto the streets? Something evidently very deep is happening. And I think our generation is going to try and understand, Kiranji, what is really the problem.
Okay, the third question. Anybody else?
Sir, can we know as a remarkable incidents in your life?
My whole life has been a remarkable experience.
Then you can say about your ambassador in USA, right?
Okay, good.
There was anything special?
You see, I was only there for 5-6 months because I was a political appointee by Rajiv Gandhi. And I thought I was going to be there for 3 years. But lo and behold, he loses the election. And when he lost the election, I had to resign because I was a political appointee. I'm not a professional civil servant. So I was only there for 5-6 months. And I gave my credentials to Bush Senior. This is in 1989. In fact, it was while I was away there that the tragedy of the Kashmiri Pandit exodus took place. By the time I had come back, the whole Kashmiri Pandit community had left the valley, which is one of the great tragedies of modern India.
Any other,
sir?
Okay, a good, happy question.
Pass the mic to her, please.
Mic, better mic.
Oh, you want to
आप दबा के बैठे उसको दीजिए ना माइक पीछे हेलो
As we all know you like music can you please sing something
yeah
I love
you
I'm not going to sing anything now
I'm not supposed to sing.
I know it's been said there's no such thing as a free lunch. With Lalit, there's no such thing as a free dinner. I mean, you've got to sing for your dinner.
Super! I love this question. Okay, friend, where
what should I sing?
Where's the background?
I can sing Elvis Presley, I can sing Dogri song. Dogri song.
He won't
Dogri.
Just call Chintan.
Dogri. Okay. Which, he's not here, no matter.
He got the background. One second.
He knew the background, he knows the song. He's very good.
Okay.
Chintan, can you play the...
What a girl.
Let him... Will you take a minute to set it up?
I know so many different songs in Urdu, in Hindi, in Dogri, in English. I don't know which one to sing. But you want Dogri, no? You want
Dogri,
my mother tongue.
Folk, yeah, your mother tongue.
बथरी दया बन जा रहा हो ओ सिरे बुढ़े बंगरा भारा हो ओ बथरी दया बन जा रहा हो ओ सिरे बुढ़े बंगरा भारा हो ओ गली गली फेरे बन जा रहा हो ओ देखे उन कुड़ी रन जा रहा हो ओ बारे धुपड़ी ते पर छाया हो ओ दिल समझाई करी जाया हो ओ मारे दुपड़ी ते पर छाया हो ओ दिल समझाई करी जाया हो ओ बाथरी दा आए वो बाथरी दा आया बन जा रहा हो ओ सिरे पुड़े बंगरे रा बारा हो ओ मासा मासा खाते चक वाले हो ओ हड किते लाड़ दे हवाले हो ओ एक हाथ चूड़ी ओ चढ़ानी हो ओ दूए हाथ गजरा नसानी हो ओ बाथरी दा आए वो बाथरी दा आया बन जा रहा हो ओ सिरे पुड़े बंगरे रा भारा हो ओ गली गली फिर बन जा रहा हो ओ देखे उन कुड़ी दा नजारा हो ओ बारे दुपड़ी ते पर जाया ओ दिल समझाई करी जाया हो
So when did you see a book release of this kind? It had to be only with this kind of a combination. Brilliant. When he said he's been folk singing and learned it, I had my heart of hearts hoping. I wish we could get him to sing. Now, you know what? You're captured in this camera.
Oh no.
And I'm going to make a 45-second clip of it and tweet it today to 12 million people. Dr. Karan Singh sang for us. And his Dogri. And it's so relevant in the current times.
It's my mother tongue.
It's his mother tongue. Do you want to still talk to him?
No. Don't say no. Get the mic back.
I think we need to let it up. Let's read it a little
longer. So, friends.
Pass the mic to us.
We have a very honorable surprise. Dr. Karan Singh has inspired a lot of people over years. The Aurodhan Art Gallery is giving him a Lifetime Achievement Award for inspiring us through oneness, through art. Says a Lifetime Achievement Award for Dr. Karan Singh for his inspiring contribution to oneness through art 2020. I cannot but just let it happen like this, because it is an extraordinary privilege to be able to give him this award, and he has the humility to accept this. It reminds me of a story from Mahabharata. When Sita wore those beautiful jewels, the jewels told her that today we are looking so beautiful, not because we are on somebody else's neck, but because we are in Sita's neck. So, thank you so much for accepting this lovely. I would request Sanjay to thank us, and I also want to thank the artist who have done an extraordinary. Yeah, he's going to thank everybody.
Dr. Kiran Bedi, Honorable Governor Puducherry, Dr. Karan Singh, Honorable Chairman, Honorable Foundation, Dr. Manoj Das, a celebrated author, and Sahit Academy Awardee and winner of other awards also for literature. Dear friends, it's a real pleasure to have you all for the book release of Dr. Karan Singh's Reflections, Anthology of Essays. This book is a collection of his essays in various aspects of Indian culture, religion, philosophy, education, and politics. These essays also focus on his own personality and how well-read and well-aware he is on each and every subject. These essays bring forth his vision and foresightedness in dealing with the various problems our country is passing through today. It is a must-read book, and everybody would definitely learn something out of this book. I take this opportunity to thank him for always motivating me. He is a fatherly figure and a guru to me, and has always blessed me over the last 20 years of our association. Hope he will keep his blessings and love for me always. I also take this opportunity to thank Dr. Kiran Bedi, Honorable Governor, for taking her time out from her busy schedule to preside over the book release. I remember printing her first book idea. So it is, the memory is coming back after meeting her today. I also thank Dr. Manoj Das for his encouraging words and honoring us with his presence and releasing the book. Finally, I thank Mr. Lalit Verma for taking care of this responsibility, and all of you for making this book release a success. The book is being offered at Rs. 500 as a special price. And anybody who wants to have it can get a copy or autographed by Dr. Sir. Thank you
all. Friends, I would request all the artists who are part of Oneness Through Art to very slowly come onto the stage for doing the photo op. I think Rajendra wants to announce something.